Good morning. I've been asked to make some remarks about energy and the U.S. economy, and I'll try to stick to that since I'm an economist. I can't help being a white male, but at least I can try being making some contrarian remarks, and that's not too hard for an economist. The theme of my remarks will be that will turn on the observation that many of our energy policies were formed during the first and second oil shocks of the 1970s. But a lot has changed since then, and our energy policies need to change along with them. And let me first look at the demand side on, in the U.S. For energy. The energy intensity of the U.S. economy has declined dramatically since 1970, and economic performance, whether you measure it by GDP growth or productivity growth or inflation, is actually much less susceptible to oil price shocks than was the case during the oil price shocks of the 1970s. The utilization of energy per real dollar of GDP has declined by over 50% through 2007. I won't include the depression/recession years. And it's likely to continue to decline in the future, even if no new policies are adopted. There are many reasons for this change. The structure of the U.S. economy has changed dramatically. Technological change in production and use of energy have played an important role. Regulatory initiatives aimed at increasing end-use energy efficiency have played a role, and higher energy prices have also played a role. The relationship between GDP growth and growth in energy uses have also changed. The elasticity of energy consumption with respect to GDP has declined significantly in the past 50 years. And that's the elasticity is basically if the GDP increases 10%, how much does energy use increase? In the 1960s, it was 0.9. That means if the GDP grew 10%, energy use grew 9%. During the 1970s, it declined to 0.45. During the 1980s, when energy prices were really high, it declined to 0.25. It rose back to 0.4 during the 1990s when energy prices fell, and between 2000 and 2007, it has fallen to 0.15. That means a 10% increase in GDP growth now leads to only a 1.5% increase in energy use. So the connection between the economy and energy use, while still important, has certainly declined. And there have been numerous studies by economists that have tried to relate economic performance to energy price shocks subsequent to the 1970s, and the impacts have been shown repeatedly to be relatively small. And this has implications for energy security policies and our views about imports of oil from other countries. Looking to the future, and if you've been in the energy business for a while, predicting the future is a prescription for going broke, and I'll come back to this. There's lots of uncertainty. But the best estimates that I rely on suggest that just taking account of the policies on the books now, and we remember we have had a number of new energy policies introduced in the last few years, U.S. energy consumption will increase very slowly over the next 20 years, perhaps at the rate of 0.5% a year, using the Obama administration's forecast for economic growth. U.S. petroleum consumption probably peaked in 2006. Indeed, OECD petroleum consumption probably peaked in 2006, and that's largely a result of improvements in energy efficiency of vehicles going forward, the growth in the use of biofuels, and the stabilization in miles driven per vehicle. U.S. petroleum imports from countries outside of North America, and I'm a director of a Canadian company. I consider Canada and the U.S. as being friends and being well integrated with one another. U.S. petroleum imports have almost certainly peaked as well under base case oil price assumptions. And U.S. CO2 emissions will be roughly flat over the next 25 years, absent new greenhouse gas mitigation policies. I consider that to be the good news. The bad news is that the situation is different in many other developed developed countries. They import much more of their energy, and certainly in developing countries. So despite what I've said about the U.S., global oil demand will continue to rise over the next 25 years, primarily attributable to growth in developing countries. Oil prices are likely to continue to rise. It would not be surprising if they doubled over the next 20 years in real terms, although technological developments in extraction from existing fields and in the identification and extraction from deep water deposits may change that price trend. Oil exports will become increasingly concentrated from countries in unstable areas of the world, the Persian Gulf and Africa in particular, as production in traditional areas, or at least net exports from traditional areas, decline as well. So this suggests that while the impact on the U.S. economy of oil price shocks may have declined significantly, the probability that they will occur may have increased significantly. And finally, flat CO2 emissions is not nearly good enough for the U.S. We're looking for reductions of 80% by 2050, and that's nothing close to being flat. Let me turn to energy security very briefly. Much of the thinking about energy security, in my view, was formed during the 1970s and is not adapted to changes in the relationships between energy and the economy in the U.S. and globally. Every president since Richard Nixon has articulated some form of energy independence goal, including up to the present. It's never happened, it never will happen, and it's not really a good idea from an economic perspective or an environmental perspective to try to make it happen. Conceptualizing energy security issues with a metaphor built around, quote, U.S. dependence on oil produced in insecure areas of the world, read the Persian Gulf, is really very misleading. But yet this metaphor continues to play a big role in U.S. energy policy. The U.S. actually imports very little oil from the Persian Gulf. The U.S. is the largest producer as well as the largest consumer of energy in the world. But our largest trading partner for the 60% of our oil consumption we import is Canada. Mexico is a big trading partner. And Canada accounts for essentially all of the natural gas that we import. Persian Gulf countries account for only about 3.5% of U.S. energy consumption and 10% of U.S. oil consumption. Our allies in Europe and Asia import much more of their energy from that region of the world than does the U.S. But these facts are really irrelevant. They're 1970s thinking. The oil market is one big integrated international pool where prices are typically quite well arbitraged across delivery locations. The trading patterns that we see reflect differences in transportation costs. It's not a shock that we import oil from Canada and from Mexico and from Venezuela and from Western Africa, and countries in Europe import oil from the Middle East, and Japan and China import oil from the Middle East. The effects of an oil supply disruption, whether it's from a disaster in some country or from cartel behavior, affects all oil importing countries, regardless of where each specific barrel of oil happens to come from. The picture of the U.S. being targeted by one or more oil producing countries and having to absorb the entire supply hit reflects a deep misunderstanding about how oil markets work today, and hopefully will continue to work. This suggests that energy security issues are global issues. A global problem requires global solutions, and other countries need to and must bear more of the burden of securing oil supplies in the future than they have in the past. And here I must note, the U.S. consumes essentially no oil to produce electricity. That wasn't true in the 1970s. 20% of the electricity was produced by oil. This suggests that promoting wind and solar, which supply electricity, provide no direct energy security benefits because they displace domestic resources or Canadian resources. They don't displace imports of foreign oil directly. The primary short-run arguments for promoting renewable energy are to reduce carbon dioxide emissions. In the longer run, an energy security story associated with renewable energy has to flow through the transportation sector. That's where 70% of the oil is consumed. And this includes electric vehicles, including hybrid vehicles, the expansion of environmentally acceptable biofuels, increases in vehicle energy efficiency, and even perhaps increased use of compressed natural gas in vehicles if natural gas prices stay low. Technological change has had in the past and must continue to have important effects on energy production and use if we are to even come close to achieving greenhouse gas reduction goals consistent with our economic performance goals. The revolution going on in the natural gas supply business in the U.S. and a revolution that's likely to spread to Europe and to Asia is a good example of how technological innovation is making large new domestic supplies of natural gas, the least carbon-intensive fossil fuel, available. And there's a combination of technological developments in horizontal drilling and hydraulic fracturing that's making gas that we always knew was there now available at relatively low prices. And these developments promote all of our economic and environmental goals. They're cheap. They keep energy prices low. They're domestic resources. They promote economic growth. They're the result of a more competitive natural gas sector, and they reduce environmental damage from energy use. And let me conclude with one remark that I think will be controversial. I think the wrong metaphor for future energy policy is the Apollo program or Sputnik or any single large-scale energy production or use technology. There's enormous uncertainty about future demand, future supply technologies, prices, the rate and direction of technological change, and other attributes of the energy system and its role in the economy. Getting locked into what appears to be, quote, the solution to mitigate CO2 emissions or to reduce imports of foreign oil would be a big mistake in my view. Creating an incentive structure that aligns policy goals with the incentives of consumers, producers, equipment suppliers, and those who finance them is critical for good policy outcomes. The most important incentive-compatible policy to put in place are appropriate charges on carbon emissions, and those charges are going to end up, if they're appropriate, being much higher than the charges that are anticipated in the Waxman-Markey bill. And we want those charges to flow through naturally into energy prices and to allow producers of energy and consumers of energy to respond to those prices in ways that make them better off. Whether it's taxes or cap and trade, and you get economists in a room, it's like arguing how many angels are on the head of a pin. It really doesn't matter to me. It's getting a price on carbon emissions that matters to stimulate decentralized incentives on the demand side and the supply side and the innovation side to identify a portfolio of competing technological opportunities to reduce our reliance on fossil fuels and to reduce the emission of greenhouse gases into the atmosphere. If you look back at the government's record on picking winners in the energy technology area, it's pretty bad. Coal gasification, not too good. The Clinch River Breeder Reactor, not too good. Nuclear waste storage, $20 billion down the drain. And going back to natural gas, the government actually played almost no role in the identification or deployment of the two technologies I discussed earlier. So we're going to bet on the future. It's not the Apollo program. In my mind, it's getting all the incentives right to make it costly to emit carbon and to allow the entrepreneurial spirit and the interest of consumers in saving money to move forward to find the best solutions and the most economical solutions to these problems. Thank you.